Hi, welcome to the third Mosaic Minute. I'm Ben Scanlon with Neethi Patel, co-founders of Mosaic Growth Solutions. And we got some feedback on our previous videos, and so we're trying to improve. And one of the pieces of feedback was, what do we do? And so I'll throw it over to Neethi to share what we do, why you should listen to us. She's very good at this, not to build
a I don't know. I ask myself that every morning. We work with companies, a lot of software companies looking to grow very quickly. A lot of the companies we work with have been successful kind of despite themselves. I like to describe it as, you know, there was a untapped demand in the market and they brought software that addressed a latent pain point. And so they're able to grow really quickly. But to get to that next level of growth for a lot of these companies will require a little bit more discipline, a little bit more of a deliberate kind of go-to-market strategy, demand generation strategy. And so we come in, partner with executives at these companies to really figure out what levers to pull to unleash this sort of transformational growth. And we help them kind of lay the foundation to do so.
And what sort of, is there any certain industries we like to work with?
Well, we, our sweet spot is definitely B2B SaaS and kind of mid-sized companies that have recently received equity funding is where we tend to kind of do our best work. But we've done B2C and we both have travel backgrounds and consumer backgrounds. And so we've done work across industries.
All right, very cool. Well, thank you for that. I feel like we've improved already, Neethi.
Which is yes. And the other piece of feedback, Ben, I have to say that I got is that I picked probably the most boring spot in my entire house to do the video last week. It was just a plain white wall.
It looked like a hostage video.
Yeah. So try to improve. You know, we're doing construction on our house though right now. And so all the walls are pretty bare. So we're getting it repainted. But I chose the best spot I could. So
yeah, it looks good. Like, all yeah. right. That wasn't the only feedback though. We also got feedback that I moved too much, which I agreed with when rewatching the video, but
it's true.
So now I'm in a straitjacket. I'm not at all. Nice. I'm trying to think, is there anything exciting going on with us? We're coaching, or you're coaching. I'm not coaching at all right now. You're coaching your daughters in softball.
I know. And you know what the bad part about coaching, actually my least favorite part is to decide when you call practice. Like when it's like the weather's not good. Yesterday, it was like, looked stormy, but it wasn't raining. And it was very stressful to make the decision. Yeah. But I decided the eight and under girls would be okay missing a practice this week. So we went ahead and canceled, but it didn't really actually rain that much. So
isn't that, that's like the toughest decision we face like all week is like what to do with practice. So.
I know. And then my daughter is like mad at me if I cancel practice. like I control the weather, but yeah.
All right. Well, We'll keep everyone updated on how the season progresses. But today we're talking about mapping the market opportunity, which is a cool topic actually. So this is, I was looking back at last week. I said we had written these articles about a month ago, but it turns out it was even longer than that ago. So I still think this is very relevant content and still very meaningful. But you know, going back and remembering exactly what we said is enjoyable. It's like reading it anew again. And I think what we found with our clients is that they don't always focus on the right buyer. They're like sales and marketing teams are misaligned on what's the right buyer. And so it's really critical for companies, sales and marketing teams to understand the segments of your target market. And so when we were talking about segments, and this is kind of a, this is kind of a unique way of looking at it, I think. I mean, I think everyone will understand what we're talking about, but Neethi has actually put together like a really good, it's not concentric circles, but a really good diagram that sort of highlights these different segments and how they progress down. Neethi, can you talk a little bit about what those segments are and you know how do you end up with the buyer you should actually be targeting?
Yeah, I think they are called concentric circles. Yeah. So if you think about circles and then circles in circles, the biggest circle that we talk about is the total addressable market. And that I like to say is what you build your investment thesis on. This is like the universe of people who potentially could ever buy your product or be a good fit for your product. It's a very big number, but it is not efficient to focus on your entire total addressable markets. Too many people, too many diverse types of buyers in that kind of big circle. So then you kind of think about what the next kind of layer down, which would be your ideal customer profile, which is who's most likely to buy your product today. What does that customer look like? Where do you have product market fit? And generally I tell clients to really think about the deals that they close and start to think about what common characteristics these buyers all have, whether it is specific industries, specific buyer personas, the size of the company, the growth trajectory of the company, how young or tenured the company is. I mean, there's so many different ways to kind of bucket different companies and really think about your ideal customer profile. But that's the segment of people where you actually have a chance of selling your product today. And it's usually a much smaller piece of the total addressable market. And then the last circle, which is super, super small, is the people within your target market that are actively looking for a solution like yours. And now I'm going to forget the number. Maybe you have it off the top of your head, but it is
3%
of people at any given moment within your target market are actually looking for your solution, actively looking. We call the active buyer. And so I would say the misalignment happens when these companies who, like I said before, I mean, they were able to sell relatively easily because there was such an untapped demand in the market. And so the leads that are coming to the sales teams are pretty much knocking down their doors to get this product because it solves such an acute pain point that has just been unaddressed for so long. But once you kind of penetrate the low hanging opportunity of the market, then you got to start thinking about, well, how do I get my product out there? How do I get my brand out there to a larger audience who may not be ready to buy, but may be in the future, may be a strong prospect, right, or buyer. And that is kind of marketing to the ICP. And so you think about it, the sales team is like, I just want people who are active buyers, right? I just want to close these deals. While the marketing team is like, I just got you a great new lead. They fit your ideal customer profile. They will be a great buyer 6 months from now. And so really thinking about where you're targeting and where you're focusing your efforts and ensuring that the marketing team and the sales team kind of understand where these folks are coming into your funnel, and what population they're a part of in terms of ICP or active buyer is really, really important.
Right. And it's one thing to like talk about it here, because I think that probably resonates with a lot of people and it seems so simple, but when you actually see this play out within an organization, we've sat in meetings and you just see it causes so much pain within the organization, because the sales team, if they have been looking for these, deals that have been like, that just completely queued up, served on a platter, and then marketing, and we go into situations where we're introducing new marketing efforts. And so it's the sales team is just not used to seeing leads that aren't ready to sign on a contract now. And it really leads to some challenges within the organization. It could really be, create a lot of tension with those organizations, because it feels so uncomfortable and it feels so different. And so you really need to work to get alignment. And so what have we done with clients to help build alignment in terms of understanding who should be targeted and what's that going to look like for these organizations?
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. And it definitely needs to be a deliberate activity. It's not going to happen naturally, that alignment. And so like going back to your just creating tension and kind of uncomfortable situations, it's not even internally that that tension is felt, right. But it's also from a customer experience standpoint. Right. You know, we're doing all these marketing efforts to capture leads who are interested in reading a white paper. And those leads are going over to the sales team. And they're like, all right, well, which part of our product do you want to buy? Or, you know, what price are you willing to pay, or whatever it is? I mean, it's a conversation that person, that lead is just not prepared to have. At all, because they show no intent of buying anything. They just wanted to read a white paper. And so I think it's twofold. I think internally it creates tension between the two teams, but I think from a customer experience standpoint, it makes the company seem like disjointed.
Right. And it's really, I think the client or the prospect, when the sales team initially engages with them and then they don't get like a really strong response, the sales team's going to check out. And then the prospect is just like, feels like disappointed in the experience. They're like, I'm not going to do business with this company because they're just like, the experience was so poor. Like, I don't want to get like, what is going to be like when I actually sign up for it? If this is how they're acting when I'm someone who's, you know, potentially interested in this product at some point down the line, and this is how they're treating me. And so this is very important to creating a great prospect experience.
Yeah. I mean, I'll say, you know, what we've done in organizations, and this is going to sound so basic, but I think it's a great exercise, is literally to draw out a funnel with your go-to-market team. Sit down with everyone and say, here's top of the funnel, the middle of the funnel, the bottom of the funnel. In the past, the sales team, you guys have gotten leads that are coming in middle to bottom of funnel. These guys have shown some sort of interest, are considering some sort of purchase, and may even be, you know, committed to buying a product and are just making a decision now. Obviously, those people, when they come to you, you treat them in a way that you would treat someone who is actively looking to buy your solution. Marketing is going to bring in leads much higher in the funnel, the top of the funnel. And these people are just becoming aware of your brand. They're just becoming aware of your product. And they likely are not aware that they have a pain point or a problem that is big enough or relevant enough to solve. Right. And so just kind of showing visually, right, we still got to get these people at the top of the funnel down towards the bottom and the middle. And so the conversation up here has to be much different than the conversation down here. And so that's kind of the first point. And then I think the second point is, so what does that conversation look like? And you kind of go into almost like a, not scripts, but you kind of play it out. You say, someone who's raising their hand and saying, yes, I'm interested in your product, you know what to do with them. Someone who's raising their hand and saying, I'm interested in what you have to say as a brand,
right,
that conversation is very different. Let's talk about what that conversation can look like. And you start to think about, you know, how do you learn more about the customer and their pain points? How do you learn more about the company and their goals and kind of their challenges today? It's a much lighter conversation that's geared towards learning more about the customer and just kind of enabling them to be more successful,
right,
outside of the product, then obviously the sales conversation.
Right. And then very practically, it's worth setting up a weekly meeting with your go-to-market team to go over these leads that are coming in and just assessing them to see what category do they fit in? What could you've done better from both a sales and marketing perspective? I mean, we primarily come from a marketing background, and so we're a little biased towards marketing at times. But I mean, marketing makes plenty of mistakes that, you know, often will drive leads that just like, you know, they're not even in the ICP. And so maybe there's something to be done from a marketing perspective, but it's really worth taking that time to look at the leads coming in on a weekly basis and just understand like what category do they fall in, which of those segments do they fall in, and what could be done better both on the sales and marketing team. And that's where you get that alignment. It's just getting a general understanding of what those where they fall in those segments and what they can do to improve it.
Yeah. And I think, you know, one of the things that our more savvy listeners may be questioning right now is, why are you sending those leads to the sales team? You know, you're saying they're not sales ready, then maybe you shouldn't be sending them. I think a lot of the clients we work with just don't have that volume of demand yet because they're just starting to implement some of these demand gen tactics to generate that volume at the top of the funnel. And so just to kind of utilize idle sales capacity, we're sending everything to the sales team and are kind of depending on them to really figure out where these prospects are in the funnel and then kind of modify their conversations accordingly. Ultimately, when you get to the good problem of having too much volume at the top of your funnel, then you can start to be choosy about who you send over to the sales team. And generally at that point, marketing is going to keep the top of the funnel leads engage and nurture them until they get to a point where they are actively ready to engage in a conversation with a sales rep. And then you pass them over as a marketing qualified lead. But I think it's worth saying that a lot of the companies we work with and a lot of people who are just kind of revving up their demand gen engine haven't gotten to a point where they need to start defining those stages.
Right, totally. All right, this is great. So the things that we're talking about are, one, just understanding the segments, whether they're in the total addressable market, the ICP, or an active buying phase, and really understanding where your prospects fall within those segments, and then actually mapping it out against a funnel with your sales and marketing team. So you have a alignment in terms of like what the funnel looks like and how those active buyers fall within that funnel. And then having a weekly meeting just to go over them on a very detailed level to understand where these leads fall, what could be done to improve the sales and marketing process, and make sure that you have alignment in terms of, you know, what categories these leads should actually be falling in.
Yeah, I think it's worth mentioning, though, on that last point, is to be very clear about the objective of those meetings, because otherwise they can get contentious, the marketing team gets defensive, the sales team kind of gets accusatory, and you're just not going to have a productive meeting. And so I almost like to think of them as a calibration session. You kind of say, going into it, I know that there may be an issue with some of the lead quality because we're trying all these new things. We need your transparent and candid feedback to help us better than calibrate what we're doing to send you better leads.
Right.
So just kind of acknowledging that, like, all the leads we're generating are not perfect. But also, you know, the sales team recognizing these leads are coming in at different points in their journey now. And so not all leads are created equal. I think just kind of having that up front and kind of at the start of the meeting is really valuable. Otherwise, you're just going to go down an unproductive path.
Totally. Yeah, completely agree with that. I mean, I would expect there'd be a little bit contentious at times, though. I mean, we had client and the sales team's understanding of who should get to sales versus the marketing team's understanding were 180 degrees opposed to each other. It's like, and the actual criteria for deciding it was like very hard to get visibility in. So, but the sales team was really pushing back on getting leads that weren't fully qualified, even though the criteria is like really hard to know. And some of it was like really simple, is like how many people worked in a certain department. And it's like, you know, from a market perspective, that's really hard to get visibility into. I mean, we can ask that question as part of a lead form, but we didn't even know they weren't talking to people that didn't have a department of a certain size. And so, I mean, this is just an example of like how that confusion can develop, because it's just the sales team had that just totally in their heads that it needed to be a department size of 20 or 8 or whatever it was, but they never share that with marketing, and marketing had no idea. And marketing couldn't even solve the problem because they weren't even aware that was a criteria that was being put on prospects. And so having that discussion was painful. I mean, we went back and said, well, are you sure this is really where you want the standard to be of a prospect that you'll consider? It seems like, you know, very black and white. You could be eliminating people who could be growing into larger departments in the future that would be an actual, then they would be in your ICP. And so, I mean, that was a hard discussion to have, but it's something that just has to happen, or you'll be having those hard discussions all the time. It's better to have it once than having it over and over again.
Yeah, or you're going to just lose prospective buyers because right. your criteria is so stringent. That same client, I remember, you know, the size that they were looking for was like at least five people, right. but like they weren't having conversations with the groups that were three people. and it's like, what if they hire two more people in the next couple of months? You know, you've already lost them now if you refuse to talk to them, you know, when they come to you. So I think that's a really good point. It's just really understanding and making sure there's alignment around the ICP and the ICP criteria.
Right. Next, we're going to tackle how to get the investors to understand that not everyone in their TAM is ready to buy. That's just a joke. That is a discussion for another day. You always go into, like we talked about board meetings last week, you go into board meetings, right? Well, this is the size of your audience. You're like, well, it's the number of people are actually buying right now is much more small. It's much smaller. And so you need to work with us here a little bit. But yeah, so that was our third video. Thank you for joining. I think we've improved, Neethi.
Yeah. I mean, you definitely weren't swaying the whole time. So
we'll see it in post-production, whether I was swaying or not.
All right.
Well, thank you for joining us and we will catch you in the next Mosaic Minute. Thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you guys.